Rock and Roll Grad School with your hosts, Heidi Hedquist and Luke Poling. They're all out of love. They're so lost without you.
Mm-hmm. Hello, kiddies. We are going to have a good time together because this week we are talking with Ron Young from Little Caesar.
Yes.
A band I don't think either one of us was that familiar with.
No.
We're familiar with that era, that world with which Ron and the other Caesars ran in.
Mm-hmm.
But he has a new memoir that is, I don't know if lovely is the right word. Would you say but lovely?
It's great.
It's a really, really fun book. He's a very, very honest fella. And I think that comes through in our conversation. The fact that he was said some very nice things to us after I edited out of our conversation.
Of course.
But it's a really interesting book about a really interesting time in music.
And a really interesting career trajectory in music.
Very true.
His story is really, really interesting. And we keep saying interesting, which makes it not interesting.
Right. Well, but, that's interesting.
Right? He's fascinating and compelling.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some really fun stories involving a lot of names, you know. Just because you think you don't know who Ron is, you'll start to be like, how do I not know who Ron is? I should know who Ron is.
Right.
And now you will know who Ron is.
Yeah. And you'll listen to the music, which is a lot of fun.
Yes.
And you'll see Little Caesar out on the road sometime soon, somewhere near you. We should note last week's guest, Tragedy, is out on the road now.
Yes, they are.
And we have a bunch of other folks coming up who are also going to be traveling. I think I'm going to go see Tragedy on Friday.
I'm going to go next week. So
this will be fun. I'm taking the elder, so we'll see how
sweet,
how traumatic that is.
No, it'll be fun.
Oh, it's not Tragedy I'm worried about. It's about Steel Panther.
Yeah, it'll be fine.
Yeah, I don't know if Friends with Benefits put my money where your mouth is.
I mean,
or Glory Hole are going to be the things for a small child, but you know, he's going to have to learn it at some point.
Exactly.
So listen to our show or go see it in person. But
exactly. Look, they've already been down the path of Kiss. This is fine from here on out.
I just, if Steel Panther opens with Never Too Late to Get Some Pussy Tonight, I've got some questions to answer.
I mean,
this will be a very interesting car ride home.
It's because there is a need for a 24-hour shelter where you can get an adorable kitten to take home for your family.
Why did you decide now is the time to write down your story and your memories of it?
Well, you know, you do interviews and you do podcasts, and over the years, all these people say, oh my God, those are great stories. You should really should write a book. And I'm like, yeah. Everybody says you should write a book. And I did this one set of podcasts with this guy, Steve Olivas, who happens to also be a licensed psychologist.
And that's what we're missing.
That's what we're missing. Somebody that actually like questions that make you dig deep into your soul.
Right.
And see the car. And I was like, you know what? And he was one of the ones who said, you know, you should really write a book. And he goes, I help people write books. And I was like, sold. Let's do it. I just had this feeling like if anybody could make sense of it and yeah, because that's what psychologists do. They sit there and patiently, though they want to wring your neck with all the stupid shit that comes out of your mouth, they keep you on point and they keep you on focus to the point where they get you to see what anybody else in your life sees is obvious, that you're too caught up in your own bullshit to see. And then, so I was like, this could be the, and sure enough, we sat down, we did hours and hours and hours and hours of interviews. And we started to compile it, and it just came about, and it was great. It was really a lot of fun, and you know, very enlightening experience, terrifying experience too. I noticed it. It's writing a book. You have that moment right before you release it where you realize, all I'm going to do is piss a lot of people off. Do I really? You've gotten this far into your life without ruining relationships by telling this story or that story. And, you know, I see it on social media all the time. It's like, oh, well, you said this. So you, and fortunately, everybody's been really, really nice and it's been really well received. So I'm very grateful. So
it's so fun. It's such, it's a great, great book. And your voice is so clear. And obviously we've never talked before, but you are exactly who, you're exactly who talked to me through the book.
Ah, great.
And it was awesome. At least you are in these first couple minutes we've been together. You might turn
this out. This could all go to hell.
It could all go to hell.
What you see is what you get. You know, it's the New Yorker in me. We don't have time for any bullshit. Let's just get right to it. You know?
Love that. Yeah. No, it's great. And it's such a great, it's just such a great journey. And there's all those moments, especially obviously during the Little Caesar eras where you're like, no, but wait, no, what do you mean that? How did that happen? How could that possibly happen?
Yeah, exactly. It's like, it's like the standing at the bus stop as all the traffic is whipping by and the craziness dies down and all you see is a bunch of guys standing there covered in mud, you know, and you've missed the last bus. That's kind of what it's like, the metaphor, you know. So, yeah. But the funny thing is that when you looked over, Gene Simmons was driving one bus and Jimmy Iovine was driving a bus. And, you know, just these sort of cartoonish, historically powerful characters, and we've got them all in our book. It's really quite amazing, you know. So
well, and Geffen backed up the bus too.
Oh yeah,
Geffen, like multiple times. See,
definitely backed up. There's one moment, which again I won't ruin anything. There's one reference to Geffen, sort of after that story, just a one sentence that I burst out laughing so hard. I'm sure my just, it was perfect. It was involving some things being sent his way. Metaphor, you know, and if the world is, if the universe is fair.
If the universe is fair. You know, this is the other good thing about writing a book. And one of the things I hope come away from the book, it's not just, you know, of course you write, if you're going to read a book about Keith Richards, there's going to be some great stories about a million people, because he's had this charm, you know, private jet ridden life. You read a book on Ron Young and it's like, who, you know? And what I wanted to come across is that everybody in their life has these things that they strive for, these things that you reach for that you really wish would happen. And be it a career choice or a relationship you try to attain or finances you try to attain, and we all gonna fall flat on our face. That's just part of life. It's a question of what you do with it and how it defines you at the end of it. Can you find the humor in it? Can you find the gratitude that you got even this close? Because it's not always about getting to the mountain. It's the fact that you got up on the damn mountain.
Right.
You know, even if you are the guy that is in the video, famous video clip of tumbling down in skis, that's me. But hey, at least you know me, you know?
Yes.
Yeah.
And if you can, if people can relate to that sort of concept, even, you know, if you can't relate to knowing exactly who David Geffen is or Jimmy Iovine, and the drugs and all these other stuff and how you got to be really careful with that stuff. At the end of the day, people I hope can relate to that and find some, you know, they see the humor in it. They see the hope in it. They see the survival in it. And that's the mission accomplished at the end, you know?
Did you always have that outlook? Did you always kind of look at the mountain and go, I'm going to get up there, come hell or high water? Or was that something you had to learn over time?
Oh no, I used to be an OCD driven, you know, it's funny because most guys get into bands because of the women and the drugs. And I got into it because I just wanted to become, you know, I wanted to do what I wanted to do for the rest of my life and have nobody tell me what, you know, I could be in charge of my own destiny and do what I love. And, you know, success was my drug. And then when I knew I wasn't going to be successful, I just said, well, then I might as well just replace that with drugs because, you know, it's not going to happen. And that's the thing. I started to self-medicate. And once, and I was so arrogant, you know, junkies are junkies. I'm just this guy that's had this rough thing went on in his life. I'm self-medicating. Once I get back on my feet, I'll put it down because I'm just so smart and I'm so driven. And I, you know, and it's like, next thing I know, it's like I've done heroin every day for 6 months and I get on a plane to go to Europe. And I was so stupid. I didn't even know what dope sick was, you know, and I hung out with Johnny Thunders. You know? Right. Y'all talk about clueless, you know, and self-important, you know. So it's just one of those things where, you know, as time goes on and things shift and things change. And unfortunately, a lot of these lessons we learn in life, we learn them through pain more than through anything else. But, you know, I never had any concept about any of these things other than, you know, you just keep pushing forward to try to do the things that you love to do in the way that you love to do them with the people that you love to do it. And, you know, to me, that was a rich life. It wasn't about, you know, owning a Ferrari or having people mob me in the streets. In fact, quite the opposite. The reason why I got tattooed was I wanted people to stay away from me. I hated the general public. I'm more comfortable on stage than after stage signing things at the merch booth, which we do every night.
Right.
Because then you might get to see the real me. When I'm up there, I'm this sort of altered ego guy where I get to be, you know, I get to have my little Wonder Woman belt on and I've got the shield of invincibility and I'm bearing my soul through a microphone. And then once I get off stage and that mic is gone and you go, so what's it like to have your heart broken like during this song? And I'm like, oh God, real feelings?
Yeah, no.
No, real, don't I look cool? Let's talk about my cool tattoos, you know?
This is how I live my life every day.
Yeah.
Nope, we're not talking about real things.
That's I look it. You put on a great black leather jacket and everybody yes. leaves you alone, you know?
Exactly. Yeah. Well, and you know, yes, your life has been, we've had all these, you know, the thing, the struggles, all these things that come up, but it's been pretty amazing too. And it was so funny. There's a part of the book where I went, oh, if I died and went to heaven, I would be at a pool party with Lenny Kravitz and Slash. This is what I would be doing. This is heaven for me. And then I read further and I'm like, oh, wait, no. Miniature cows, miniature horses, puppies, kitties, big horses, this is heaven right here. Like, this is it. Like, I've changed my mind. I mean, I'd take them too. Like, Lenny and, you know, Slash could come over too, but
riding a mini pony.
Riding a mini pony.
it's heaven or is this an acid trip?
Well, right.
Fine line. You know,
it is a fine line.
Be very careful.
But all that suffice to say, where you are, it's a beautiful life, every step of it.
Yes, and I that sense of gratitude I hope comes across in the book. You know, it's funny because all these things, I mean, like, you know, as I write in the book, 6 years old, getting on television, candid camera, all these things, these weird sort of star-crossed, you know, how many six-year-old kids in the nursery school is like on a national television show holding ice cream cones with Alan Funt for all you youngsters out there? That's an old school reference to a TV show. But,
yeah.
You know, but, you know, so just this weird thing going through life that you were meant to be something in the public eye, you know? And it's just so weird that you get to this point where you start to, yeah, you're standing at Slash's house after his house got crushed in the earthquake in his new house, which it's also kind of bizarre to stand outside the house with all of the caution tape around it because they red tagged it.
Yeah.
And him telling you to be careful because there's some highly venomous snakes that you can't find that are roaming the property. And I'm like, yeah, let's go down to Starbucks and get some coffee. And he's like, and I'm just like thinking, well, this is kind of irresponsible. And he's looking at it like they're his babies. Right. It's like, oh yeah, there's a black mamba missing. It's like, you know, it's anyway. So yeah, these sort of bizarro things where, see, I'm a fan of music way before I'm a maker of music. I, you know, if I bump into Paul Rogers or if I bumped into Mick Jagger, I'd be a blithering idiot. I wouldn't be cool enough to go, hey, yeah, you know, we're peers. I was on Geffen Records and we should exchange vocal techniques. No, I'd be like, oh my God, dude, you sang this thing in this thing. And that's the way I've always been. I just don't ever consider myself any sort of, well, you know, you worked with Bob Rock and Jimmy Iovine, so you're up in that realm now. And it's like, no, I'm just a guy that sang. And the magic of music is never lost. And other people that make it, and the art that they've created, I'm too close to my own. I just do what I do. So if people come and they clap, great. If they sign me to a record deal, great. I figure, you know, one day they'll come and tell me, pat me on the back and tell me to go home, and I'll go home. But, you know, so these sort of experiences, I'm all bubbly and giddy too, you know? So I try to have that come across in the book as well.
I think it does. I think it really shows that that passion for music is there and very much alive. And I think it's one of the things that makes it such an enjoyable read, because like you said, you're going, oh my God, the temptations are right here. Or, you know, like it's the same excitement level of like, this is insane. I can't believe this. Is there is there anyone who you did become a blathering idiot in front of, or top five?
My worst experience was with Paul Rogers. We did a benefit in Houston for a radio station. They were doing a big radio drive, I don't know, for some really good cause. And they brought in people from all around, and they were holding a big concert at the Astrodome. And so I was lucky enough to come in, and I was going to sing a song with, it's me, because Earl Slick was in the band at the time. So me and Slick were going to do something, and Aldo Nova and all these other people were there. So they put us up in this one hotel. And so I'm in the hotel, and in walks Paul Rogers. He's checking into the hotel. And I'm like, here's my chance. I have to go up and tell him just how amazing I think he is. So I walk up, and all of a sudden, like the 15 different voices in my head all was shouting out questions at the same time. And I was like, so you know, when in the, and then you, that thing that you know, that, and he just pats me on the shoulder and goes, I understand. And he walks away. And I was just like, oh my God, that was so lame. And he handled it with, he just, this big smile as I was going through this 10 seconds of complete mental breakdown of all the things that I was trying to bring up to him. Which are my favorite songs? What about his vocal technique? Oh, by the way, I'm not just an idiot, I'm a singer in a band, and I work with this guy. And so it's just this sort of random synapse firing of nonsensical babble. And I gather it happens to him enough times that he knew exactly what I was going through. And I was so embarrassed. And I saw him across the room two or three more times. And I was, well, if I go over to him, I'll probably call security because now he thinks he's got a stalker. And I just avoided him. And I've had a constant lifelong regret to never try to have that conversation again with him.
Yeah, you do want to make it all right now. Yeah, I get that. When you sat down to write this, was there one section or one story that you were like, this has to go in? Like, this is the thing that I know is going to make it a good book and make it something worth people's time and their money.
Actually, here's the interesting thing about writing a book is like I said, the panic that sets in afterwards. And I did more editing than I did padding. Because I got to be honest, I've got friends in different art forms that are famous artists and all this stuff, and some people that I've left out of the book because I felt like it would just seem like I was name dropping for the sake of trying to increase cross appeal and all these other things. I did not want this to be sensational, or I wanted it to be a journey of not one of commerce, but really more of just for the journey. And so, you know, there's things like, it was funny, we got to the end of the book and I was like, I didn't put the whole Terminator story in. So we had to sit down and I had to tell the whole Terminator. And I was like, oh my God, I can't believe we almost forgot to put Terminator in there, you know? Because that was a funny, interesting, another weirdo story about how that all came about. You know, so just little things like that. And then, you know, how do you handle talking about, you know, every band has breakups. And so we have, you know, a couple of few members that left the working relationship of Little Caesar. And I wanted to give honest, accurate representations of why there was a disagreement without any character judgments or bashing. Sometimes you just got to agree to disagree. And so I tried to handle that. Again, you know, there's people that you can love, but you just can't work with anymore. And I love every one of the people I've ever made music with. For whatever reasons, can't, you know, just doesn't work anymore. Like, again, people can relate to that in their personal relationships. Yeah. You know, we've got boyfriends or girlfriends who are smoking hot or really fun to be in bed, but oh my God, you can't be in a relationship with them.
Several of those.
Exactly. So, you know, again, all these things that I thought would be relatable, you know.
And it is. It's totally relatable. You go through it and it's not sensational. Like, you feel like how I would feel going, like, there are days that Luke and I go, I cannot believe we just talked to that person. Like, what, how did this just happen?
Right, right. Yeah.
And you just laugh. Yes. And so, that side of you comes through clearly. So you have that like excitement as a reader where it's not just like, oh, here it is, another rock star who hung out with Gene Simmons. Well, all right. Put that with all the other bios. It's just the whole way it comes through is really fun.
And, you know, if people go, you know, oh, yeah, you know, do you have any regrets? And, oh, if you, and listen, you can count on a very short list the number of people in rock and roll who are rich and famous, who are being held up as the poster children as functional adults. So, you know, having a lot of money or nice cars or a long list of desirable sexual partners, or if that's the bar you held up when you're young. As you get older and you see and you watch some of these characters of excess get older, you know, your values change and people go, oh man, if you were to become as successful as Jimmy Iovine and David Guetta, and I keep saying, I'd either be dead or an asshole. And I don't want to be either. I've had this great life. I've gotten to do all these things, and you can't take one thing out of any equation of life and go, oh, I changed this so that could happen. I've done enough life to know that that is a dangerous, dangerous you know, we've seen science fiction movies where people go back and change one thing in the wrinkle, you know? So I watched enough of those movies to know. So for me, I'm just really, really grateful that I get this really well-rounded balance, you know, that I can tell all these goofy things. And I'm also to the point where I can, you know, I have this small band of loyal fans and followers, and I know them all. I've gotten to know them all through social media and their kids and their lives and their, and because I've never related to myself as the rock star, you know, it's all fun, you know, everything's got to be fun, excitement, and you know, and gratitude, you know. Yeah. It's not a matter of what you have. It's a matter of if you're grateful of what you have. You know, that's really what all of life, this is the secret, you know?
And I think that comes through really, really strongly in the book, that there's not a lot of regrets. There's a lot of appreciation of what you've learned along the way. And to go back to what you were saying, even about some of the former members of Little Caesar or other musicians you've worked with, you give them so much more than a fair shake. And kind of saying, it didn't work out. Here's my side of the story. Here's what I think, but I could be way off. And even that, just to allow them the space to go like, well, Ron's got his story. I disagree with it. But it's so much open and willing to accept blame. And I think when you get to the stories of your addiction, it's very much going, yeah, I, you know, like you're saying before, I did something really stupid and did not understand what I was getting into. And I think that's one of the main takeaways from the book, is that sense of gratitude and appreciation for what you had, what you have, what you've lost. It all kind of comes up. And I think in that way, presents a really well full portrait of you as a person and as an artist.
Well, thank you. I'm grateful that comes across. I have no desire to be right, you know, in everything. I learned this by getting sober, you know,
mm-hmm.
if you keep your humility, if you keep the open-mindedness that you could be wrong, if you're always looking for what your part in something is, then, you know, at the end of the day, that's when the torture goes away. You know what I mean? It's like if I would have gotten a phone call from Earl Slick or David Geffen, and he goes, dude, you are so talking out your ass about this story. And this is how it really went down. You know, I'd be like, oh, shit, that's not the way that it came across.
Right.
But at the end, that's okay. I'm okay with being wrong. You know what I mean? There's no... Mm. All right, yeah, I was wrong.
Yeah,
it's a burden off your shoulders. It really is. So, you know, it's this whole thing. You know, learning how to be self-deprecating. What I've learned is if you don't take yourself seriously, you're never offended.
Right, and it's great.
I am never offended. There's really nothing anybody can say to me where I just go, oh my God, that's the most, yeah, you're an asshole. Uh-huh. I believe me, I know I can be. Yeah. So it's like there's a lightness to being. There's a day-to-day existence that you can walk around. And listen, I'm sure that we've all known certain personalities in rock and roll who really take their bios way too
much. Oh, yes.
Seriously. And quite honestly, I feel sorry for these people. Especially, I don't know any young rock stars. Are they even rock stars anymore? They're pop stars. Mm-hmm. I don't even know if there's rock stars anymore. But it's just... And it's funny because like Gene Simmons is one of those guys. I used to sit there and like one quick story was we pulled into this hotel and he's standing, he got there before us and he's standing at the front desk in like his sort of like silky bathrobe. And he, and he's at the front desk saying how he wants strawberry ice cream. And the guy at the front desk, well, first of all, we don't have, it's past 10 o'clock. We don't have room service here. And Gene is telling him how, well, only the finest hotels have room service. And he only stays in the finest hotels. Therefore, there must be some room service.
Makes sense.
It's Binghamton, New York, dude. This is not Paris. Number one. Number two. Then he goes in to say, well, sir, we don't even have strawberry ice cream when room service is open. And Jean proceeds to tell him how, oh my God, only two types of ice cream. And I'm sitting there like this. This is actually like taking the precious moments of a man's life away to argue with some guy who's just out of, you know, hospitality school working the night desk in Tipton Holiday Inn or something. And he then Gene goes, well, you know, I'm Gene Simmons. And I'm like, oh, if you've got to say I'm Gene Simmons, right. Then, oh. And then he goes, I'm sure that if you look in that refrigerator, you will find Gene Simmons strawberry ice cream. Even if that means that refrigerator is down at the 7-Eleven. And so the guy's like, well, he goes in the back and I walk up to him and I'm like, wow, dude, have you ever eaten strawberry ice cream that hasn't been spat in? And he's like, probably not. So he knows.
Yes, but that is the beauty of Gene Simmons.
He knows. This is like his entertainment.
Yes.
It's like this, he's got this. It's why I love him as a genius. Right. He being that character to him is like, is like he walks around in his pirate suit all day and he's buckle.
Yes.
It's hysterical.
It is. And he fully owns it. He
does.
It's amazing.
He is totally cool with it. And I'm like, oh my God, I don't know if I should worship you more or hate you more.
I know.
It's like, I mean, really, it blows my mind. And you know, to him, like he says, he was Liza Minnelli's business manager when we were on tour with him. He's like, I've never taken a vacation day in my life. I've worked every day of my life. And I'm like, why? And he goes, I just love all of this so much. And I'm like, well, I guess teachers are eat. Everybody's drug of choice is their drug of choice.
Yeah, you know? For sure.
But again, it's so hard to hate someone that knows exactly what they're doing. They're not an asshole. Right now, I'm being an asshole because that's what I play on TV.
Right. Yes.
And then there's times I hung out with him and he's incredibly warm and funny and loving and easygoing. And I'm just like, wow, I wanted to hate you. And then all of a sudden you do something and I really like you, you know?
Sunshine, blue skies, please go away. My girl is found another. Gone away with who in my future. My life was filled with gloom, but day after day I stay locked up in my room. I know to you it might sound strange, but I wish it would always.
Judge's book by its cover by Ron Young is available right now wherever you get your books. For more information on Little Caesar, to get tour dates and everything else, check out their website, littlecaesar.net.
Rock and Roll Grad School is produced by the Professional Production Company. Please be sure to rate and review us on Apple Podcasts, because your impassioned review is just as honest as us standing backstage waiting to come back on for the encore. For more information, you can check out our website, rockandrollgradschool.com, And like everyone else, we're on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
Today's show was recorded and produced by Heidi Hedquist and myself from our world headquarters located on the second floor of the Professional Office Building, centrally located downtown. Our reluctant executive producers are John Sauvay and Sandy Stone. Our willing executive producers are Rachel Allen and Randy Jeanette. Our intern is Zach Jackson. This one's for Philippe. Thanks for joining us. Good night. Drive safe. May all your favorite bands stay together.